I'm not going very far.
It's too uncomfortable.
I'm in a hurry.
Sometimes I just forget.
There's no such thing as a good excuse for not buckling up. You're not only putting yourself at risk of injury or death, it could also cost you lots of money. Cops are writing tickets, so why take the risk? Do the smart thing and start buckling up every trip, day or night. Click it or ticket. Paid for by NHTSA.
Hey everyone, lovely Laura asking you, when you think of wrestling snacks, what comes to mind? Hot dogs? Popcorn? What about you, Bob?
Oh, some escargot, oysters Rockefeller, maybe a nice quiche.
You look like a quiche.
Seriously, folks, if you're looking for an awesome treat or a wrestling-inspired gift endorsed by both wrestlers and wrestling fans alike, look no further than Turnbuckle Cupcakes.
You can find Brandy and Julianne on their Turnbuckle Cupcakes Facebook page or visit them at www.turnbucklecupcakes.storeenvy.com.
Everybody, this is Bunkhouse Bob.
And the lovely Laura.
Folks, live from the Armory Wrestling Show is heard Wednesday night, 7 o'clock Eastern Time on FNX.network. Where else would you tune in to hear the greatest wrestling mind of the 21st century?
Yeah, I'm not impressed.
You will be impressed. Folks, catch us on FNX.network Wednesday night, 7 o'clock Eastern Time.
Welcome to Live from the Armory Wrestling Show, the premier podcast of indie wrestling.
Folks, this could be a slobber knocker.
Our studio line is area code 213-816-1605. With your host, Bunkhouse Bob.
No, wait. I am the Bunkhouse Bob. I am the greatest wrestling mind of the 21st century.
And the lovely Laura.
Let me tell you. That man is a genius. He is a genius.
Hey, everybody. You're listening to Live from the Armory Wrestling Show. My name is the Bunkhouse Bob. This is episode 216. Live from the Armory Wrestling Show. We've got a great guest coming up for you at 7:30 as we continue with Women's Wrestling Month. Joining us this evening will be one Tasha Steelz. We're very excited to have her on the program. Can't wait to talk with her. Folks, we thank you for listening to the show, no matter how you're listening. If you listen as we do it live on Blog Talk Radio, you catch us on the Apple Podcast app, on Stitcher, on YouTube, on FNX.network, on. It's like I'm stuck on repeat. On any of those platforms, we just thank you for allowing us into your lives for an hour, hour and a half every week. We certainly appreciate your support. We would encourage you to go over and check out our good friends at Indie Customs. They're on Twitter at Indie_Customs. We are a part of the Indie Customs family. I want to say hello to Kimberly Ann and all the good folks at Indie Customs. Thank you very much. We would also encourage you to go over to www.igniteadvocacy.org or go to Facebook and type in Ignite Advocacy up in the search bar. Check that out. Make sure that you tell Kim Artlip that we said hello. Great organization that hooks people up with different types of resources for different types of situations, hailing out of the state of Florida. And again, we would encourage everybody to go over to www.fnx.network, the newly revamped website. There's a lot of great stuff over there. Make sure that you go over and check them out. And to get to the meat and potatoes of it all, because the past couple of weeks, George Coles has been filling in on helping out Coach. Really appreciate all of George's input, and his support, and his help, and all that good stuff. And, you know, for whatever reason, I don't know, I feel like I should play a song. I should play a song just because, I don't know, I've been stuck on stupid for like the last 3 weeks, if that's possible, being a genius, you know. But sometimes you just got to let songs play in the background, you know, because Laura's back and she is like a real American as well. You know what I mean? Hey, Laura.
Thank you, Bob. I appreciate that real American on there. I just want to let you know that you've been stuck on stupid for 49 years.
How was club?
Oh, Lord. I tell you what. Insurance is not for sissies. Getting your insurance license is not for sissies, ladies and gentlemen. So,
see, and that's why we're playing this song, when it comes crashing down and it hurts inside. You know,
that's when you go
right
to the bathroom.
I got to turn this off. We've been playing this song for like 3 weeks now, and it's getting old. So we want to turn off Hulk Hogan's theme song. I'm sorry. I don't know. I'm going to leave it in the dashboard, so I can play it randomly whenever I like.
You should definitely play Paradise by the Dashboard Light by Meatloaf. Could be your little theme song there.
Well, you know, we probably should, but again, we'd have to dip into the budget and do one of those multi-digit withdrawals, $1.99 on iTunes, and bust the budget doing that. So I don't know if that's in the cards or not, but we'll see what we can do.
I'd rather bust a move. I've been busy. Thank you so much to you and to Mr. George Two Show Coles.
Did you listen to last week's show? Because George had two shows under his belt, and all of a sudden he got to start to be freewheeling. He was just starting to ad-lib, start throwing stuff in there. I thought I was going to have to get out the lasso and reel him in. You know, really have to bring out the Bunkhouse Bob deal and say, hey, Coles, listen. You know, you can't just come on the show and, you know, just start taking over. He thought he was like in the NWO. Over. He's throwing toothpicks around the studio. All that shit. It's funny.
Yeah, somebody's got to pay for them toothpicks and pick them up. So, I mean, it ain't going to be me. So, I'm just saying. But, no,
exactly.
I did not. I heard the end of the first week show that I was gone when he forgot to do the whoop whoop. And then he just started talking over everything.
Yeah, he just started blabbing. I don't know. I was just laughing. I was out. I had pizza waiting on me. I was starving to death. I couldn't wait on him to go on another 10-minute rant about Kazuchika Okada. I was like, come on, George. Enough's enough.
Domino's is waiting for me. Come on now.
Exactly. My goodness. Crazy stuff. But you had insurance. Everything went okay.
Everything's good for now. I passed the practice test. I take the license exam on the 12th of June, which is a day after my birthday. So if everybody would cross your fingers, say a little prayer if you're inclined to do so, or send me some good vibes, I would really appreciate it, because I definitely am going to need it.
Right. We can do that.
I do appreciate it.
I know that you got ring rust, so let's shake off the ring rust and get into it.
So let's do. So you've said all the thank yous and whatnot. So it's my turn to talk about the social media. Tonight we have George One Twitter Coles. I'm going to come up with all kinds of nicknames. manning the Twitter machine tonight. You can tweet along with him, and I'm sure Bob and I will interject at some point, at From the Armory. You can also follow along with me in my everyday life at Circle Sky. I've been taking a lot of pictures of flowers recently. My irises are blooming. And
very
you can
nice.
Follow along at, thank you, appreciate it, at Bob_Delp for Mr. Bunkhouse Bob and Mr. George, I guess that's two Twitter now, Coles, at Heel Heat. And you can also.
I just thought it. George, I run two Twitter accounts, Cole.
And our good friend at the Gray Lobster with Dr. Goose, which he brought up a good point. I didn't know this. I'm going to the Raleigh SuperCon in July. John and I are going to go. We're going to meet Dave Bautista. We're going to meet Trick Stratus. I'm going to meet Abraham from The Walking Dead and Lou Ferrigno. Queens of Combat is also going to have a show there at the con.
Okay.
So just wanted to point that out. Dr. Goose had dropped that little knowledge on us. So go follow at the Gray Lobster. You will not be disappointed. Also, you can find From the Armory, live from the Armory, on Facebook at our official page and our fans page. Just Twitter. I'm really rusty. Just Google Live from the Armory on Facebook, and you'll find us. Also, you can find us on – I'm rusty. I really am.
Just Google it on Facebook.
Just Google it on Facebook, you know, what all the cool kids are doing nowadays. You can also engine Live from the Armory, and you can find us. All the shows from the past 2 years are up, so – depends on how you want to listen to us, whether you want to listen to us on Stitcher or iTunes or FNX or Blog Talk or YouTube. I felt like you with the record on repeat.
Exactly.
Yeah.
Repeat on and on and on and on. Yeah, I know what you mean. It's crazy.
So, yeah, that's what... That's what I've been doing. On and on.
And I should say, we give George a lot of crap, but I honestly want to say this. George did an excellent job filling in the last couple of weeks. And if you haven't been over to www.fnx.network, go over and check it out. The graphics that are up for the individual shows, the ones with Thunder Rosa, with Zoe Sky, everything that's pertained from this week or from this month. George did the graphics for that, and they look really, really sweet on the website. So make sure you go and check it out. You know, George, I'm just yanking your chain because I can. It's been that kind of day, that kind of week, and the laughter.
George.
I needed the laughter tonight for sure.
George, two chains, Coles.
something like that. Speaking of, and George is the guy that is responsible for coming up with our Twitter polls, whether you love them or hate them. This week we had 60-some-odd votes on the poll. So why don't we go over the poll?
Let's go over the poll. On the poll. The question is, of the following promotions, who has the best women's division? And their choices were Ring of Honor. And the winner of our poll this week is Impact by a very narrow margin of 48% to WWE's 45%. That right there, I'm being remiss by saying Ring of Honor got 7%. I would agree with that about 2 or 3 years ago. I'm not so sure I agree with it so much now. I think Impact is building back their knockouts division with wonderful additions of Sue Young, Tessa Blanchard, Kiera Hogan. I'm not so sure I agree with this, but that's just me.
Okay. Why would you not agree with it? I mean, just for the simple fact that Impact's behind the curve, or the talent that WWE has in the pipe?
I think it's the talent. I mean, you've got Charlotte Flair, you've got Asuka, you've got Bayley, you've got Sasha Banks, Ember Moon, my girl Nia Jax. You know, I just think I would, like I said, 2-3 years ago, I would agree with that assessment that, you know,
okay,
Impact had the better roster, but not, and I'm not dogging their roster right now. I think they're building back up, and I can't wait
right.
to see what happens. You know, in Rosemary, how could you forget Rosemary in Impact? I mean, she's awesome. But I just think from where it was before, you know, with people, Awesome Kong and Gail Kim and, you know, the beautiful people and Jessica Havoc and just people like that. I mean, their knockouts division, we talked about it before, would literally knock out the Divas division, which is what it was called at the time. But, you know, that's just me.
Well, I mean, let's play devil's advocate for a minute on this, because I think I kind of see where some of this might lie. And I think some of it's sentiment, or it's a sentimental vote.
Yeah.
Because
I think you're
like
right.
what we were talking, you know, what part of what we had on the list to talk about was this week on Impact in the women's division, you had Sue Young, Rosemary, Tessa Blanchard, and Kiera Hogan. I think wrestling fans, beyond casual wrestling fans, are very familiar with all four of these talents. And to have all four of them on a particular broadcast bolsters the fact that Impact is paying attention, just as to what the WWE did a couple of years ago to the independents and bringing people in. All four of these ladies are strongly regarded as great workers and great in-ring performers on the independents. That's not to say that the WWE has fallen off from that, but you remember, WWE had a ton of mass signings 2 or 3 years ago. Some of them have been subsequently released. Some of them have subsequently sat in NXT. There have been a few that have been called up. But the machine runs at a little slower pace than what Impact does. Impact, you're immediately on TV. In WWE,
right.
we have to go through the NXT developmental system. And we talked about this on the program before. You could be in developmental for anywhere from 1 to 4 years, depending upon what's available, or maybe not even at all. You know, after a certain period of time, there's already been a couple of high profile releases, both men and women. So I think it's maybe one of those, I hate to even bring it up, is it one of those instant gratification votes?
Could be.
I know that you had mentioned that you wanted to talk about your girl Nia Jax and the angle that was on
yeah.
Raw Monday night with Steph and Ronda Rousey and Nia and some back and forth that went on. What's your thoughts on that?
Well, I'm really disappointed in the WWE again by focusing on Nia's side. You
okay.
know, and what really bothered me was the fact that Stephanie McMahon called her lazy. Now, I know she was saying that, you know, people thought she was lazy, or someone
right.
had thought she was lazy. I get that. But
right.
the fact that that's code for me for saying you're fat.
Okay.
And I'm getting tired of the fact that that's what this woman is being judged on all the time. Not the fact that when she first came to the main roster, she was green as goose shit. And she has made incredible leaps and bounds since getting to the main roster. And that's all we can seem to talk about. I love how the fact that she's the only one that has her weight announced. The only woman who has her weight announced. Why
you know, I never
that?
Paid attention to that. I never paid attention to that.
Yeah, she's the only woman. And why is it, I mean, can we not just, you know, get past the fact she's a larger woman? I mean, can WWE not have a champion of her caliber and it not be about, I never heard, you know, excessive amounts of this about Awesome Kong. I never heard TNA going on and on about how big she was. It was maybe, you know, she's bigger than Gail Kim. Okay. That's all, not to be, you know, punny, but it's, that's awesome. I just think that this, it's a roadblock for Nia, and it's not even her fault that people can't get over this. And what makes me think that it was code for something was like when she stood up and said, you know, I've heard that lazy myth all my life. And
right.
That makes me think that this is not, you know, what about her is lazy? That's what I want someone to explain to me. It's, how is this woman lazy? I think it's, you know, somehow in people's minds that if you're fat, you're lazy.
Let me ask you this. Okay, go ahead. Finish your thought. I'm sorry.
No, I'm just, you know, I just think minds are going to have to change. And it's hard to change people's minds. But I think it's going to have to start at the top when one of the key principal owners, quote unquote, of the WWE is sitting there, you know, in front of this newly signed, you know, superwoman, the savior of us all, Ronda Rousey. And it's not anything bad about Ronda either. It's just the way she's being booked and portrayed in front of her. And I'm like, why, again, are we putting over MMA stars who are wanting to be wrestlers over people who've been wrestlers? I can't understand that either. Why are we doing this?
It's a merchandise machine, basically, and it's popularity. And it's several things wrapped up into a giant burrito, if you want to call it that. I like the angle between Rousey and Jax. I would have preferred it to go on a slow simmer and then
right.
trade some friendly pleasantries back and forth a little bit. And then if you're going to have Nia come out and say, you know, have somebody ask, you know, what, you know, why would you challenge her, you know, the entire time, why would you come out like this and then blow it up that, you know, I'm blowing up because of who she is. You know what
right.
I mean?
Right. Mm-hmm.
That would have made sense to me. Now, I wonder if this isn't some type of reverse psychology, almost in the sense that when they're announcing Nia with her height and her weight or whatever, and they continue to bring this up, and we talked about this with Zoe Sky last week, whether or not this, in a sense, is reverse psychology in that allowing people to believe or to dream that anybody of any shape or size has the potential or the opportunity to be at that level. Do you know what I mean?
And I'm totally fine with that, too, you know. Yeah, like, oh, gosh, she's, you know, she weighs this much. You know, I weigh this much.
And she's there. Right, and she's
there,
and
she's
doing it.
And I could get that. But the fact of the matter that bothers me is that, you know, the whole angle with Alexa Bliss bothered me tremendously. And then you've got this now. You've got one of the owners of the company, you know, insinuating that you're lazy because you're fat.
Well, we talked a little
bit
with
Zoe.
That's
what bothers me.
Yeah, we talked a little bit with Zoe about the whole bullying, body shaming issue, and, you know, I had led into it with, you know, how wrestling imitates life, and I mean, we see this, you know, prevalent, you know, throughout society and everyday life, day to day, and you would, you know, this is not beyond, I don't believe that the WWE is beyond addressing any type of situation. I mean, we've seen much more far-fetched, you know, believe me, that they wouldn't tackle this day-to-day issue. And, you know, I guess the comeuppance, the payoff is her winning the title, you know, being the bigger person and that, you know,
right.
hard work perseveres. But, you know, did we have to get, you know, did we have to get there to that point in front of a young, impressionable audience? And then we got into, you know, maturity levels and how smart kids are today versus what they were 20 years ago and so on and so forth.
Well, I mean, there's still a prevalent sector of the population that thinks that if you're fat, you're no good. You have no value whatsoever because you don't look like this person or you don't look like that person. And, you know, it's almost like a Pyrrhic victory. Was it worth it? Was what did the means justify the results? You know, I mean, or did the ends? Did the end justify the means? Sorry.
Yeah.
But did it? Did it? I don't know. Because
I don't know if it did.
And I love the whole I'm not like most girls, which, by the way, I ordered that T-shirt as a birthday present to me. But yeah, I just have a problem, you know, because this is something I face every day. Because It's not like, this is what I've heard. Oh, yeah, you're pretty for a big girl. No, I'm not pretty for a big girl. I'm pretty, period. Okay? You're not prettier than I am. You're just thinner than I am, okay? There ain't no way. There's no, don't get it twisted, okay? So, yeah. Tell me that bullshit. That I'm, you know.
I love it. That's awesome.
But you know, it's just it's a subject that's near and dear to my heart, and I just don't. I think that if we're going to get over that issue, that body image issue, that you know, all women have to be stick thin, that's not going to help it. You know,
that
it just
true.
Really isn't. So that's, you know, I'll come down from my soapbox. But I do like the fact that, you know, the idea of a feud between the two of them, I'm just not so sure that Ronda deserves a title shot.
But,
hell, she's not even had a singles match.
I don't, and it, that was brought up, and I don't think that it is either. And again, I think that that played beautifully into a story if it was allowed to give time to brew up just a little bit.
Right.
I don't think that we need to have the contract signing out in the middle of the ring right off the bat. But, you know, of course, we're in the fast track society of pay-per-views and buy rates and all that other stuff. And if this were back in the day and you had a 3-month buildup for this, can you imagine the draw that would have been there?
Yeah. Oh, God.
Not just in pay-per-view buy rates, but in house shows, because they would have interacted in house shows, maybe even had dark matches. So, you know.
Oh, yeah. That would have been awesome.
Money. Absolute money. Speaking of money,
yeah.
I want to get in two things real quick. The big news this week, WWE stocks rose 19.1% on the announcement that SmackDown Live will be moving to the Fox network in 2019 at an estimated $1 billion for a 5-year deal.
Holy moly.
And that's right, folks. I said $1 billion. That's a lot of money. Maybe a lot of money. And the other thing that I wanted to throw out real quick was it was announced this week. AML announced that its July 29th show, and we'll certainly cover it as it gets closer. We'll get to everybody. We'll get to see you. We'll get to see your prettiness. July 29th show versus Impact Wrestling will be aired on Twitch. So if you have the Twitch app, you can subscribe to Impact's channel, and I don't think that AML has a Twitch channel per se.
They don't.
But I know that for certain Impact does. So you can subscribe to the Impact channel, and they play endless videos on Twitch. The stream runs 24 hours a day besides special events. They play best of and anthology wrestlers, all that other stuff. I don't think I've ever seen it not be on. So you want to make sure that you check that out, the July 29th show for Impact versus AML will be aired on Twitch. So with that being said, I want to go on and get our guest on for this evening, because I'm really excited that we were able to get her on. And if I have this correct, and no big long introduction from me because she doesn't really need one, I'd like to welcome to the show Miss Tasha Steelz. Tasha, are you there?
Hi, yes, I'm here. How are you?
I'm good. How are you tonight?
I am doing very well, you know, just being Steelz, all Steelz all the time.
All Steelz all the time, and there's nothing wrong with that at all. Things good for you on this Wednesday night?
Oh, things are actually looking very up for me. I just came home from doing a long hour and a half in the gym, and I'm feeling pretty pumped. Pretty good. Feeling very Steelz-like here.
Okay. Very cool. Very cool. With me on the other end of the line is the other co-host of the program, Laura. Laura, you want to say hello to Tasha?
Hey, Tasha. I'm glad to be back finally, and what a great way to do that, by interviewing you.
Oh, thank you. How are you, Laura?
I'm doing well. Doing very well, and it's Wednesday night. We've got you here, so couldn't be much better.
Yes, I'm very excited to talk to you guys.
Awesome. Awesome. We'll go on and get started then. We've been talking a lot, Tasha, about the dynamic shift in women's wrestling that has occurred. And something that I thought about over the last week is, are wrestling promotions in danger of burning the fans out, trying to make up for the ills of the past with a lot of card stuff with women's wrestling? I mean, it wasn't that long ago that we either only saw one women's match on a card. Now sometimes you get two, three. Now there are at least, let's see, one, two, three, four all women's promotions that I know of that I can name off the top of my head. Are we at risk in burning out the momentum that's going on?
No, I don't think so. You got to remember, like, back in the old school days, women's matches were like, the popcorn matches or like the bathroom type matches, where you saw like more gimmick matches as well. You know, women with the bra and panties or the pal and the pole or stuff like that, you know,
right.
Really not showcasing the talent that us women really have. So nowadays, you know, we're really just, I do have to give that credit to the WWE and starting that women's revolution for giving women more of a chance to perform and showcase their talent on, platforms such as WWE, Women of Honor, TNA Impact. Now you have, all like four women's promotions, one I am included on. It's just amazing to see that now promoters are starting to recognize women's wrestling, like we can get in there and we can do the same thing as the boys. We can, if dare I say, do more than the boys. We put our bodies on the line and we're very dedicated to this business just as much as they are. And I'm pretty proud to be a part of something that promoters are starting to see a lot more of. And I'm, pretty proud to be a part of things that, we're able to just come up and just showcase a lot, that we're more than just a pretty face and having a nice body, that we can do a lot too, maybe a lot more than the guys.
There's this ongoing debate that seems to bounce back and forth like a ping pong ball about who's responsible or where credit can be given when it comes to this women's wrestling revolution. And you mentioned the WWE. A lot of people will point to the WWE by helping guide the casual fan back into women's wrestling. There was the Give Divas a Chance movement on social media. But in the independents, women's wrestling has been prevalent and women have been busting their asses for a number of years. It just so happened that fans may have gotten fed up at the WWE level. Who do we give credit to? Do we give it to the promotions? Do we give it to the fans? Do we give it to the wrestlers? Or do we give it to everybody?
I would have to say, you know, that credit is just, it starts with, like, what's the top promotion? You know, you have WWE. They have the biggest audience, correct? So they showcase more of that Give Divas a Chance and the Women's Revolution. I don't want to say I'm going to give 100% to that credit to WWE, but majority of that percentage goes to them because they have a stronger audience. So everyone's watching WWE more. So once they see that women can actually wrestle, okay, now they're turning to the indies. Okay, what promotions have women's wrestling? People are starting to look and see, okay, can these girls really fight, or is it just something that they see on TV? You know, now they're seeing, oh, okay, just not the girls in TV can fight, but the girls in indie promotions can fight as well. And that just draws more of a crowd base to the indie promotions and the women's wrestlings out there. And so, yeah, I'm just going to have, like, give that partial credit to WWE because, like, you know, they're on TV and everyone watches them on TV and pay-per-view. And if it wasn't for them just starting that more and more and showcasing that more and more, then I don't really think that too many fans are going to, like, tune into women's wrestling a lot more. I mean, of course, they're going to be people that would tune into women's wrestling, but not as much as what they would see on TV.
Fair enough. I read in another interview that you did that promo work doesn't intimidate you. Do you feel that this is an area, because of past limitations of ring time in women's wrestling, that today's women have an opportunity in promo work that they may be overlooking?
Wow. I mean, I don't think so. No, not really.
Okay. Do you feel like taking a call from a listener?
Sure.
Okay, let's see what we got here. Let's see, 814, you're on with Live from the Armory Wrestling Show and Tasha Steelz.
My question for Tasha is, I know recently you wrestled in a Catholic church. So did the priest and the clergy come out for your match to watch it?
No, there was no priest or clergy to come out and watch it, unfortunately.
maybe they had to give a blessing. Maybe they blessed the ring before the show. Maybe that's what
they
happened.
They did that.
Okay. There you go. Okay.
And also, would you have a problem if they actually announced, like, the woman's weight, or you think that'd be too sensitive for the woman to be able to handle that?
I'm sorry, what was your question?
On the show today, they were talking about how they only announced Nia Jax's weight. They did that for all the women. Do you think the woman would care about that or not?
I honestly, in my opinion, I don't. There's a few things that you really don't ask a woman, and that's their weight and their age.
Thank you.
I don't feel like we don't need to display something like that, you know? I kind of find it a big deal. I mean, you know, you either love us or you don't, you know. It doesn't matter our age or our weight. As long as we look good, that's all that matters.
That's true.
Preach it.
814. Yep. Thank you for the call tonight, 814. Appreciate it.
Okay. Thanks for taking the call.
Sure. There we go. Yeah. Laura doesn't mind me saying that she's 63 years old on air. She's never minded that at all. So, I'm just kidding.
Well, Laura, you're still awesome, Laura.
Thank you very much. See, Bob.
And after the show, I'm going to need a priest. I can tell. I just know. at any rate, we'll move along. Tasha, you were involved with the most recent Rise show with Impact Wrestling, and we've talked in the past with those that have been involved with Rise, and they weren't quite sure how this concept was going to work. That it seemed to be a big gamble to some of them, especially early on. What was your experience like? And is this a model that would work in other areas of the country?
So recently when I done Rise, it was actually my second time doing it. And I just, things that can just showcase us women wrestlers without having to have a big male wrestler's name attached to it, I feel like it's pretty awesome. And going back to, like I'm saying before, you know, promotions that are showcasing women's wrestling a lot more, it's just, it's an amazing feeling. I actually had a great time because, you know, you had Gail Kim there, you had Jamie Jacobs there, and they were just so welcoming, and they were just great when it comes to, like, criticism, feedback with matches and everything like that. And I've watched Gail Kim for a long time, and just being in the same room with her, I was just, you know, very excited and willing to learn anything that she was willing to give out. So it was a great experience for me, you know, and I honestly think that this promotions like Rise and WWR and Nova Pro, I feel like these promotions will definitely work the more that they grow, and not just in U.S., Canada, U.K. I feel like these type of promotions just showcasing women's wrestling will grow tenfold, and it would be just the best because you have so many great talent. Like, you have – the list is just so endless, and how can you not watch us? You know, we just have it. We have the charisma. We have the look. We have the body. We just have the fight in us. We have everything. And how can you just not watch us? So I feel like, you know, these type of promotions or anything like that, they're just amazing to be a part of.
Awesome. Ladies and gentlemen, if you're just joining us, we're speaking with Tasha Steelz this evening. Tasha, Kevin Knight is credited as your primary trainer, whom has been involved in every aspect of professional wrestling, from the WWE to training those that we've seen in the WWE. There is also the Team Adams aspect of your training with the Rip Rogers, Damian Adams family. Were the two schools of thought as far as what professional wrestling is or isn't far apart from these individuals?
Okay, so I started with Kevin Knight, and I learned a few things with him for a short amount of time. I wasn't really with Kevin Knight and IWF for too long. I was attending a Rip Rogers seminar where I met Rip Rogers and Damian Adams, and it was about like around September 2016 where I joined Team Adams, and you know, from there I've been a part of Team Adams and learning under Damian Adams, who was trained by Rip Rogers. So I've learned so much, and it's a huge difference. I've learned so much, and my success in wrestling has been because of Damian Adams and learning under Team Adams, because it's just been a big difference from IWF and Team Adams training. And so I have to kind of just correct you a little bit, because majority of my success and my learning and everything has come from Damian Adams, and I really wouldn't be where I am and continuing the success where I am today if it wasn't for him. So once again, not to discredit Kevin Knight or anything like that, but yeah, I've learned a whole lot from Damian Adams, and he teaches so much, and he's just one of the best women wrestling trainers, and also, you know, male wrestling trainers today. And you know, he just breaks down everything, you know, psychology, promos, just calling matches on the fly. Like, when I did IWF, wouldn't know how to call a 5-minute match on the fly in the ring at all, you know. And when I started with Damian Adams, and, you know, he kind of tested me out with that, I was just like, what is that, you know? So you know, I've learned to do that, you know, when I went and started with them. So, you know, I can call some matches, you know, psychology is there for me, you know, he's teaching everything, footwork, and it's just, the list is just endless. And like I said, I wouldn't be where I am if it wasn't for Damian Adams.
Now, we've had Deonna Purrazzo and Karen Q on this show in the past. Both of them are accomplished in their own right, and you've wrestled them both. Does bragging rights come into play at some point, given the circles the three of you have traveled?
A little bit.
Come on.
Deonna and Karen, they are just two amazing girls, and I am privileged enough to say that they're not just, you know, people that I train with. they're also my friends, and I can call them my friends, and we can talk outside of wrestling. We can talk wrestling. We can just, when we travel on the roads, we just have just the best time ever. And you know, I don't mind bragging about that, because I've learned so much from them, and just learning from their aspect and their experiences. And me, you know, I'm the one coming in out of the three of us, the least experienced. So being able to travel with them and see what they've done, and being able to go ahead and walk behind their footsteps, you know, it's amazing to me. So I, you know, give it up to my girls too. So, they're truly amazing girls. I love them. And, you know, I'm blessed to call them my friends.
Very cool. Very cool. Laura, go ahead.
Thank you, Bob. First off, I would like to but I want to put you on the spot. Bob was talking about promos just a moment ago, and I'm going to ask you to cut a promo on Bob.
What?
Cut a promo on Bob?
Yeah.
Why she got to cut a promo on me? Why can't she cut a promo on you? Why does it got to be me?
I'm not you. It's got to be you.
Okay.
Oh, man. Totally on the spot here.
Yeah. Totally on the spot.
Now you guys got me blushing. I'm totally on the spot here.
Unbelievable. See, there's dead air. She doesn't know what she. Maybe ought to give her a. I don't know. Maybe ought to give her a lead in, like, you know, like I'm the champ or something, or I'm the intergender champion. And there's no way that this kid, Tasha Steelz, is going to walk in here. It'll be a cold day in hell. I'm going to let a girl like her, a little girl like her, come in and take my belt from me.
Oh, Lord, he done called you a little girl.
Ooh, Bob. I thought you were better than that, Bob. See, when you come to little girls, La Reina de la Reina is no little girl. And cold day in hell, this fiery Latina, it gets hot up in here, you understand? Because now you're coming against La Reina de Puerto Rico, the Boricua badass, Tasha Steelz. And don't forget it, Bob, because when you're looking at me, Monday, Tuesday, Wednesday, Thursday, Friday, Saturday, Sunday. It doesn't matter. It's always all Steelz all the time. ¿Entiendes?
Fuego.
Yeah, please don't hurt me. I was just kidding. Here's the belt. You can have it. It's all yours. I'm out. I just retired. I'm leaving my boots in the ring. Thank you, folks. Good night.
That's awesome.
That's all you wrote,
folks.
There you go. Awesome.
That was awesome. That was great, you know, because I guess with WWE, a lot of that is scripted and for them and everything. But it's great to hear someone just to do that right off the cuff and go with it. Awesome.
Thank you.
You know, you were talking about Rip Rogers a little bit. We were talking about Rip Rogers a little bit ago. And, your trainer, and goodness, his name just Damian Adams. I had it on the tip of my tongue, just went whoop. Sorry about that. You know, we talk about the lack of in-ring psychology on the show. We talk about that a lot with indie wrestlers, and it seems from what I can gather from Rip's Twitter feed that, you know, he is really all about that less is more. And what do you think it would take for in-ring performers to implement some ring psychology? It just seems like, you know, they know it's there, but take advantage of it, I guess is what I'm trying to say. They know about in-ring psychology, I would assume, but a lot of them just don't implement it.
Well, one of the things I learned from Rip, he always says, get in, get out, don't get hurt. So yeah, he's all about less is more and safe is always better. I just think most wrestlers, they're just giving the fans what they want. You know, some fans are there to see, like, quote-unquote, the spots. seats, you know, and most fans,
right.
and some fans are there to see actual wrestling matches. You know, some promotions when you go to, you can't tell, like, you know, what they want. It's just like when you get in there, it's just the feel of the crowd. Sometimes you can have a match plan in your head, and once you get in there, it's like the feel of the crowd and who they want to see win, who they want to see lose to. It's just that right there kind of like just changes up a little bit. But I think, you know, the psychology does, it is there, you know, in most matches when you watch them. But like I said, it's all just most wrestlers giving the fans what they want. And sometimes fans, you know, they don't want to see that traditional wrestling. Sometimes they want to see some high flying spots. Most times they want to see dives and suicide dives and backflips and all that type of stuff, you know? So, it comes a long way from that traditional just headlock story or arm story. So, I wouldn't 100% put it on the wrestlers, because they've all at some point in their training careers have learned psychology and calling matches on the fly and stuff like that. So I believe they're very multitasking, so they could just do it all. Like they can go from doing a traditional wrestling match to, all right, fans want to just see spot, spot, spot. So they'll just do a bunch of spots for a good 10 to 20 minutes, you know? So, yeah, it's just all the feel of the crowd, like what they want to see. And you always don't want to disappoint the fans, because they're the ones that's paying to see us. They're the ones that's coming out and supporting us. So it's just basically just giving them what they want.
You know, Bob, I don't think anyone's ever given us that answer.
No, I don't think so either. And I've heard this argument, and I can't remember whose social media page that I saw this on, but it was talking basically about exactly what you said, Tasha. Wrestlers are giving fans too much of what they want and not enough of what they need. Something along those
right.
lines, paraphrased. And, you know, you get what you got, and, you know, next thing you know, we're going to have a 450 inverted plancha corkscrew into a Canadian destroyer as my finisher. And it's just like, yeah, I don't know if we necessarily need all that, but, you know, it puts asses in seats. And at the end of the day is what people want.
Yeah,
that was a great answer.
Thank you.
I'm sorry. It really was. I've never heard, no one has ever, you know, put it in that perspective. And it makes me think about it totally different now.
Thank you. Thank you very much. Well, you also have to think here, too. You know, you have those promotions who have the death matches. Like, where's the wrestling psychology in that, you know? And fans are popping to see somebody get hit in the head with chair 52 times or a glass in their head or something like that. You know, it's crazy. But at the same time, like I said, we're getting paid for what the fans want. So this is what they want to see. Sometimes they want to see just a comedy match. Sometimes they want to see two wrestlers just have a dance contest. You know, it's just all the feel of the crowd, and that's just how I feel. And like I said before, it's not 100% the wrestler's fault, because most of us, we want to go out there and put on a great wrestling match and just really teach the fans wrestling. But it's like they want to see, oh, I want to see a dive, and they're calling for it, and they're clapping their hands for it, and all that stuff. So it's like, well, we got to go and give them a dive now. So that's
right.
what's going to make them want to come back, you know?
Right.
So when we're, you know, chanting dive, we just got to remember,
mm-hmm.
you know, we're getting what we're asking for. Talking about Riff Rogers a little more, I ask people that I know that have had dealings with him and have trained with him a little bit, do you have a funny Riff Rogers story? Because the man says the F-bomb more than anybody I've ever seen in my life. Even more than Cliff Compton.
Yeah.
Oh, my goodness. Oh, man. Rip is just being Rip. That's all it is. And you can't change him. And that's just like one of the things I love about Rip. He is just himself. He doesn't care where he is, who he's talking to. He's just going to be himself. And it's, you either like it or you don't, you know? And he's from the time I met him, he's kind of like, he likes to rib me a lot. So, but that's for another conversation. But yeah, Rip is amazing
guy. We'll have to get you back on the show.
Yes. Rip is an amazing guy. And, I actually, you know, whenever I can pick his brain, I just love picking his brain about certain things when it comes to wrestling and all that stuff. And, like I said, you know, he's great. So, you know, I enjoy his conversations sometimes when he's not ripping me.
I grew up watching Rip Rogers, and he had, and I've always wanted to ask him what happened to Miss Brenda Britt. She was a valet that he had in the Georgia area and maybe in Texas somewhere. I know it was in Georgia because that's where I saw them. And I just want to ask, Rip, what happened to Miss Brenda Britton? What happened? I want to ask him that. I've never met him, but if I ever meet him, this is the first words that are going to come out of my mouth. What happened to Miss Brenda Britton?
Hey, listen,
he was great.
He's always on his Twitter. So if you just tweet him out that little bit, he'll answer that for you.
I might just do that. What happened to Miss Brenda Britton? Last question I have for you. I'm just curious because there's certain things when I travel that I don't leave home without, and I know that you travel a lot. So what is one thing that you don't leave home without when you're on the road?
I have a 4-year-old nephew that I truly, truly adore, and he's kind of my motivation for me to keep going in wrestling, because he loves just watching me. And I have a picture of the two of us, because unfortunately he moved to a different state or from where I live. So it's kind of hard to see him, and we have like conversations every day, but I just love, you know, being around him. But I keep a picture of the two of us, and I keep it in my bag, and anytime before I go out, I just, you know, I look at it, and I just feel so motivated, because I know this guy, he wants to see me succeed, and he supports me 100%, and, you know, I love him for that. So besides that, you know, always got to have, you know, of course, my phone on me, you know.
Got to have the cash flow,
got to keep the money with me. And the music, I always gotta travel with some music. So thank God we can have download music on our phone, because that helps me as well, get pumped up and excited for when I'm about to go out there and kick some ass.
There you go.
With one more question, Bob, because she brought this up. So
sure.
What is the one song on your playlist that's kind of like your dirty little secret that you don't really want people to know that you listen to, but it's kind of like, that's my jam?
Well, Laura, see, now if it's my dirty little secret, I can't tell everyone.
Well, it's not so much as a dirty little secret. What would people be surprised that you have on your playlist?
I have a lot of country music on my playlist. Nobody really expects me to listen to country music. I don't know why, because I love music in general. Like, I have, like, a lot of soundtracks. I have musicals. I have a lot of things on my playlist that I listen to, because when I listen to music, I don't just listen to, like, lyrics or chords or anything. I listen to, like, instruments, and I hear the beat, and that's what, like, gets me into a song, you know, like how a certain drum is played, or how a certain mix is mixed in with the song, or if there's any type of instruments being played, if there's like a melody, how the piano is being played inside the song, like those type of things, just, it gets me excited, you know, when it comes to a song. So, I have like, yeah, the one main thing is like the country music that people are surprised about. And every time I say, yeah, I like country music too, and they're like, what? Like, I would think you just like nothing but hip hop and that's it and bachata,
right,
merengue and salsa también. It was just all that they're expecting me to listen to, and I'm just like, I listen to that like less than what I listen to, more of like musicals and country music and R&B and stuff like that. Like when I feel like turning up a little bit, then I'll listen to like, you know, the hip hop and all that stuff. But mainly I like to just be calm and soothing sometimes. So I like listening to stuff like that.
That's awesome.
Awesome.
I never would have, you know, expected that either. Wow.
No. That's cool.
See?
That's cool.
Tasha, this next topic has come up with our guests over the past couple of weeks, and I'd like to ask it of you, just as I asked it to the others. Is it necessary or not necessary for a major television promotion to have a title that can be won or defended by either gender, such as Lucha Underground does it with their titles? Is it necessary or not necessary, in your opinion?
Like you said, like an intergender title?
An intergender title or any title that can be vied for by a male or female. Say if the WWE United States Championship could be held by a woman or by a man.
I don't feel like that's too important. What's in a title, you know? It is a reason for certain people to work and fight for, but there have been a lot of great talents that sometimes have never won championships, and they're just known for their great talent and they're big off that. So I don't feel like a title should define anyone. I'm sure some people are going to be like, what the hell is she talking about? But to me, I feel like it's all about the talent and what you can do, because anybody can just walk around and carry a championship, you know? So I don't really think it's too necessary, but then again, it's just my opinion, you know, people
sure.
can, you know, disagree with me. So, but you know, I feel like it's more, I feel like the talent is more important than anything else, you know?
Okay. What steps do you see coming next, whether it's on the independents or at a bigger level, that will ensure the women's wrestling movement continues to move forwards and not backwards?
It's just basically us as women doing our part and performing and keeping you guys interested in us, and we're doing our part. So, I just feel like, the next step is just showcasing more women's matches and more promotions, in which there are. As long as we're doing what we're supposed to be doing, I don't see us going backwards at all. Like I said, there's too many great, talented women out here that we're going forward and we're pushing that wall down and we're breaking it down and we're just going forward. There's no way for us to go back. So we're doing our part as women wrestlers and bringing our talent out there and showing what we can do. That there's no other way to go but up from here.
Speaking of showing what can be done, what events are you going to be at coming up so that if fans want to come out and see Tasha Steelz wrestle, where are you going to be at the next couple of weeks?
Well, this weekend, this Memorial Day weekend, is going to be, like I said on my Instagram and Twitter, it's going to be lit. Because on Saturday, I will be at Battle Club Pro. That's in Ridgefield Park. And the name of the title, it just fits me so well because it's May the Queen Ring. And who better to reign than La Reina de la Reina, Tasha Steelz, okay? So I'll be keeping my crown and showing all these other girls how a queen truly reigns. And that's Saturday. And then Sunday, speaking of Karen, Karen and I, we will be going to Beyond Wrestling, and we'll be on the WWR pre-show all day. And we will be tagging. We'll be going against two very talented women, which is Jordan Grace and Lufisto, which is Team Pog, PAWG.
Mm-hmm.
And we're Team Adams is going to have to dominate there as well.
Very cool. And you mentioned your Instagram and Twitter. For fans that want to connect with you on social media, how can they do that?
Yes, yes, yes. So you can go on my Instagram and Twitter. They're both the same name, at Real T Steelz. That's STEELZ, no S at the end. Facebook is Tasha Steelz. So stay connected with me for upcoming matches, dates. Wanted to see some silly stuff. I do that too on my Instagram stories, you know, check me out. and just stay tuned for everything all Steelz all the time.
Very cool. And merchandise, Tasha Steelz merchandise? Is there a pro wrestling tee store, or other than obviously connecting with you at the venue for pictures and such, or is there any other alternative source where fans can get those?
Yes, absolutely. You can go on prowrestlingtees.com/Tasha Steelz. If you happen to be at any of the shows, I do have a brand new t-shirt out. So you can catch that soon on prowrestlingtees.com. But in the meantime, you can just direct message me on Instagram, Twitter, Facebook. I answer all three. Or just come to one of the shows. Just come support women's wrestling. Come to the shows. And you can buy my merch there and support other women and buy their merch. And, you know, keep us going.
Awesome. Tasha, thank you so much for being on the show tonight. We had an absolute blast speaking with you.
Yes, we did.
Just a great
time.
Thank
you.
We certainly thank you for, yes, taking time out of your evening to be with us. It was awesome. Thank you so much.
This was so much fun. Thank you guys so much for having me. This is truly a pleasure. I truly appreciate it. Laura, you stay amazing, okay? You stay amazing no matter what nobody says.
I certainly will, and you do the same, which I have no doubt that you won't.
Oh, thank you.
Thank you, Tasha. We'll hopefully see you down the road at the matches. Thank you so much.
Absolutely. Thank you, guys. Have a good night.
You too. And there goes Tasha Steelz, and we'll be back right after this brief message. Hey, everybody. Bunkhouse Bob and Lovely Lori here. Folks, does the man make the title, or does the title make the man? Age-old question with a simple answer. That is, if you're wearing a title made by Top Rope Belts.
Established in 2006 and with a satisfied client list, including Lucha Underground, the LA Dodgers, New Japan Pro Wrestling, Ohio Valley Wrestling, the National Wrestling Alliance, and many, many more. Top Rope Belts uses 100% custom drawings and does all of their own etching. That means quality from start to finish, folks.
Folks, whether you're a private collector, a wrestling promotion, or a business who wants a quality championship title belt, look no further than Top Rope Belts. Check them out on Facebook or visit them at www.topropebelts.com. Tasha Steelz was pretty awesome, wasn't she?
Sure was. I like her a lot.
Yeah, she's
she busted out some Spanish on you. Did you have any idea what she was saying?
I had not a clue. But it sounded mean and intimidating. I don't think it was meant with good intent. Yeah. I'm not sure. There was a lot of tongue rolling there, and it didn't sound good. So I don't know. I'm taken back
by it.
Queen
of Queens.
Yeah, exactly. Is that what she was saying? Sorry. What part was that? Because my Spanish is
terrible. Reina de Reina.
Reina de Reina.
Now, I can't roll my R's like that, but that's what she was saying.
The only thing I can tell you is no hable española. That's the only thing I can tell you.
Well, first of all, you're not. That's not Spanish. I hate to say that.
No,
I don't know.
Okay, no
what
hable
kind English. Of messed up that. No.
I don't know.
No hablo español.
Okay, how about this one? Sorry, no speak English. How about that? I don't.
That's awful, Bob. That's awful.
At any rate, very cool to have Tasha on the show. Some very valid points there. She had some good stuff
definitely.
To talk about.
I'd never thought about it from the ring psychology. I never thought about it from that aspect. I never thought that maybe it's us, the fans, that are killing in-ring psychology.
You know, I've been sitting here trying to rack my brain thinking about who said that. And I want, for some reason, I want to say, and this is a toss-up, this is terrible. I wanted to say it was either Jax Dane or Lance Hoyt, I think, is who I read that.
My God, Bob, how many guests have we had on the show? We can't remember everybody.
I know. No, I was reading it on their social media page. You know, that...
Oh.
That the fans are the ones that are, you know, trying to dictate, you know, you can't allow the fans to dictate everything that goes on in professional wrestling, you know, and I know the fans don't want to hear that. I mean, we hear it every week from fans, you know, why didn't this happen or why I don't like this or, this sucks, or this is the drizzling shits. You know, I don't understand why this happened. You know what? You don't get everything that you want in pro wrestling because it's pro wrestling. I mean, that's just the way that it is. So.
Well, the whole Daniel Bryan thing, I think, spoiled people. You know, because I'm not that Daniel didn't deserve what he got. I'm just saying I think that kind of spoiled people. Like, oh, we wanted this. We demanded it, and they gave it to us.
Yeah. Can you imagine the backlash that would have occurred that if it didn't happen, if he hadn't won
Holy
the title with Mania?
Shit. Yeah.
That you talk about fans being upset. At any rate. But,
I have a question for you, Bob.
Yeah.
I got a question for you. You know, we were. Okay. I asked her what her dirty little secret was, and on her playlist. So, what's a song that you're not so proud that you listen to?
That I'm not so proud that I listen to.
Yeah,
or something that people would be surprised is on my playlist.
Either one.
I mean, the stuff that's on my playlist, there's nothing that I'm not proud of, I guess. I mean, because I enjoy all genres of music. I think probably people would be most surprised that I have The Scientist by Coldplay on my playlist.
Really?
Yeah.
Hmm.
Yeah. It's a good
very
song.
Very interesting.
I'm very eclectic. I can listen to almost anything.
Yeah,
except for
sure
like polka
are.
Music. I can't listen to polka music for extended periods.
I love
periods.
Me some Weird Al polka. Are you kidding me? Oh, man. But my dirty
what?
Little secret is Miley Cyrus's Party in the USA. When that song comes on, I'm like, yeah, it's my jam.
You're kidding me, right?
Mm-mm. Not at all.
You got you like your hip thrown up your hands in the air like you just don't care.
Not in my
head
like yeah. Moving my hips like yeah.
Oh my goodness. Okay. Well, if you say so.
Don't hate. Celebrate.
I'm not hating. I'm not hating. No. I know that I had put down here. I put it down, but I didn't put it in the info, so I pulled it up real quick because I knew you were going
to
say.
What am I supposed to do with that?
What am I supposed to do with that? So I'll go on and say it. The show that we just threw out, because it's Memorial Day weekend, there's not a lot of shows that are going on. There are some shows that are going on, but there is a show for fans of AML Wrestling, Battle at the Fairgrounds, Friday, May 25th. And this is at the Winston-Salem Fairgrounds Annex in beautiful Winston-Salem, North Carolina. That's Friday, May 25th. For information on that show, you can go to www.amlwrestling.com or you can find them on Facebook at AML Wrestling. So make sure that you check it out. I know that the Gray Lobster had wanted us to mention that the Queens of Combat show was off the hook this past weekend. And that the venue, the new venue that I had told people about the week prior, Hebron Hall, to give us their thoughts on it. He had nothing but rave. What's that?
I didn't say anything. It's my phone going off. Twitter's blowing up.
Oh, I was going to say I heard a warble warble or something. I don't. Anyway.
Yeah, that's what it was. Twitter's blowing up.
Okay. About Hebron Hall, the video setup for Hebron Hall is just out
right.
of this world. Venue's a little smaller, but I think it gives people more intimate feel. Kind of, you know, the sizing reminds me of the old Turner Studios. I know that's not what it's called, where Georgia Championship Wrestling was taped at in Atlanta.
Yeah, and World Championship Wrestling before it became WCW. Yeah, I know what you're talking
right.
about.
Right. And I'm trying to remember the name of that damn building, and I can't.
It's, oh, hell,
something.
I think it's.
Where's Cole's at when I need him? He probably doesn't.
Speaking of that, I just want to throw out this really quick that George Coles, you might be surprised, is a big Britney Spears fan.
He is. Something Studio. Something
Turner?
Studios. Now, I don't think it was called Turner Studios. At any rate, maybe Coles can find out.
Oh, Something Wood. Something Wood Studios. Wasn't it called Something Wood Studios?
I don't know. But it has that, from what I've been told, it has that that old, you know, that feel similar to the sizing of the Mid-Atlantic Sportatorium in Gibsonville. So I think that fans are in for a really unique treat given that environment, and from everything that I've read, the show is off the hook. And I believe that if it's not already available, that it will be available very, very soon on highspots.com. Cha-ching. So make sure that you go to High Spots and check out Queens of Combat and the Diva Diaries and all that good stuff. So that's what I know.
Yeah.
That's what I know. Trying to find out something here.
The Gray Lobster had a great idea.
Mm-hmm. What was that?
So, he's inspired by my getting our guest to cut a promo on you. So we should have a booth at WrestleCape. Cut a promo on Bob. Bob. The super genius. Let's cut a promo on him. I love it. Let's make it happen.
No, we don't need to make it happen. We don't need to do that. We don't need to do that on a weekly basis.
How about I hold off on everything until WrestleCade?
No.
How about I be nice to you up until WrestleCade?
How about you be nice to me up until WrestleCade? And then what happens at WrestleCade? That's when you let all the meanness out?
Exactly. It's when we cut the promos.
Oh, my God. We'll go on and announce next week's guest, because I've got a feeling that perhaps next week I'll have a little bit more smoother sailing, so to speak. I won't have a promo cut on me at the very least. Scheduled to be with us next week, wrapping up Women's Wrestling Month. And it's not always about women that actually wrestle, but it can be about women that are involved in wrestling. And we have Kimberly Ann of Indie Customs will be joining us next week. And we're going to talk about how we take a passion like pro wrestling and we turn it into a business venture. And she's been had the opportunity to be at a lot of different shows around a lot of different names. And we're going to talk to her about what Indie Customs does and what the Indie Customs family is all about. So we're going to have Kimberly Ann on next week from Indie Customs. So looking forward to talking to a lady in the wrestling business. What do you think about that?
Most certain. I think it's great that she has a lot of sponsored athletes under this name, under this brand. It's going to be interesting to hear how she got all that started.
Yep. Absolutely. Absolutely. Is there anything else that you feel like talking about, or you ready to wrap it up for
tonight?
I'd
just like to say that I'm glad my BFF is back in the States. He just got back from Australia.
I heard he was detained.
He was not detained.
I heard that he asked for political asylum in Australia from the tyranny of the United States government, and he's being held, is what I heard.
You were fed false information, hashtag fake news. And I would just like to say that two former guests, Pan, recently, and kind of met up in the street because they're old rivals. That would be our good friend Jason Kincaid and our good friend Chase Owens.
Yes. Yes, I saw that picture. Very cool. I think they were
very cool. And,
standing out in the street. Yeah.
Yeah, I mean, I saw them both at Smoky Mountain a long time ago. And I would just like to point out that we've had two members of the Bullet Club on our show.
Mm-hmm.
We've had Mr. Adam Page and Mr. Chase Owens. So we're all in.
Mm-hmm.
Have been since the get-go. So I think we need to, maybe set our sights pretty high, Bob, and get, the Bucks or Cody Rhodes or you know, Mr. Marty Scurll on the program here, or even the cleaner, Mr. Kenny Omega.
That'd be pretty cool.
These are lofty goals, Bob, and the best thing about a goal is having one.
That is true. That is true. And we have reached out to Cody Rhodes on this very program, and we are waiting for a response. Anytime, anywhere, Mr. Rhodes, that you have the time and availability to talk, we are more than willing to listen. So if you catch wind of it, Cody, anytime. Do want to say one other thing. Folks, if you're ever in need of a clutch player, whether it's, well, because I'm sure that is, well, I don't know, maybe his college eligibility would be intact. But if you're a pro team, a pro NBA team, and you're looking for somebody to come off the bench and pop a three-pointer off at will, all you need to do is put Mr. Number 1 George South under contract.
Wasn't that
the
awesome?
2018 version of Spud Webb reincarnated, George South, draining threes at will with no effort at all. Awesome.
Yep.
Awesome. Loved it. That was a pretty cool video. You remember he was telling us that story about doing the charity basketball game for the NWA?
Yeah.
And he came in and played.
Nothing for fun, kids.
Drained a three with nothing but net, and they told him to go sit down because he was making them look bad. So he still got it, kids. He still got it. And you don't want to get into a game of horse with George South, especially for money.
No.
So, folks, we thank you very much for listening tonight, no matter how you listened, if you listened as we did it live on Blog Talk Radio, whether you catch us on the iTunes podcast app, on Stitcher, on YouTube, or over at www.fnx.network, we thank you for your support. We'll be back here next Wednesday night, 7 o'clock Eastern. Our guest will be Kimberly Ann of Indie Customs. Hope you enjoy your week, and remember, there's never a bad seat here at the Armory. Thanks for listening. We'll see you next week.
Whoop, whoop.
You have been listening to Live from the Armory Wrestling Show, the premier podcast of indie wrestling. Listen to us on blogtalkradio.com every Wednesday night at 7 p.m. Eastern Time. Subscribe to us on iTunes. Follow us on Twitter at From the Armory. We're also streamed worldwide on www.fnx.network. And we're also available on Stitcher. You can find us on Facebook at facebook.com/live.armory.9. If you like what you hear, please take a few moments to give us a 5-star rating on iTunes. Thank you for listening. See you next week.
Not going very far.
It's too uncomfortable.
I'm in a hurry. Sometimes I just forget.
There's no such thing as a good excuse for not buckling up. You're not only putting yourself at risk of injury or death, it could also cost you lots of money. Cops are writing tickets, so why take the risk? Do the smart thing and start buckling up every trip, day or night. Click it or ticket. Paid for by NHTSA.